Hey everyone, this is Xue Fan, application engineer at Sontech. Now, since we released the RS5, we fielded tons of requests regarding what you can do after your data collection in terms of post-processing. So that's what this video is about today. I'm going to basically talk about the RSQ software meant to go with the RS5 and some basic functionalities as well as the exciting new features that you'll be able to find in the software. So before I get started, I do want to mention that even if you don't have an RS5, you can download RSQ, install it, and actually also download some sample data files to play with as well. So feel free to go ahead and do that and give it a spin for yourself. So with this video today, what you can expect first is a general overview of the software, what you can find in the software in terms of the layout, some of the useful screens that you'll be able to see, and that sort of thing. Then I'll talk about some of the new features and the added capabilities in terms of post-processing that you will be able to perform on any of your data files collected with the RS5 and also data files with the M9 or the S5. And then I'll just go over some basic functionality and useful features that you'll likely need to use when you're actually doing your post-processing. All right, so let's just get started. General overview of the software. I've got the software up and running right now, and I'm going to open a data file. And here we go. And again, this is one of the sample data files that you'll find downloadable from the website. So this is kind of the data landing page when you open an already collected data file. At the top, you'll see a whole bunch of tabs with each transect that's part of the data file. And so you'll notice immediately if you're an M9 or S5 user, all the transects there will be separate. But with the RS5 and RSQ software, all the transects and all the files associated with your measurement are actually stored together in one single data file. So that really just cleans up your workflow. If you have any moving bed tests, like for example, this data file has an SMBA test, it actually has two, one had an error. Or you know, if you have a loop measurement, those will pop up here too in the top tab. Then on the left here, you'll see different icons that show you the status of different things during your measurement. And when you click through your measurement, you'll see the status icons change depending on what happens in the field. And then you'll see your table here, and these table parameters, as well as most other parameters in the software screens, are customizable. So you can pick what you want to see and what you don't want to see. And if you look below here, you'll see the QC warnings window. Now, this is a really handy tool for you in the field, but also in post-processing. So you'll be able to see all the warnings and errors that you get during the measurement. And for example, this measurement has a couple invalid bottom track samples. And if you click on any of those, you'll be taken directly to that exact sample in your data file. All right, so below that you have the SNR plot, which is a diagnostic tool for you to evaluate the quality of a given sample. So again, that's changed every time you click on a different sample. All right, so again, these plots are customizable. Right-clicking on these will give you different options in terms of what to plot. Although here, I'm plotting the magnetic error on the left axis, for example, vertical beam on the right axis, vertical beam depth, excuse me. Then in the middle plot, we have the ship tracks. So the blue track is from bottom track. And then the purple and yellow tracks are from the various GPS options. And then below that, we have the speed contours. So this is your velocity contour when you're actually taking the measurement. And in this particular case, we've got a measurement. And if you click down on the left cursor here, you'll be able to move this around. We have a measurement here that's about 300 meters wide, and at the deepest, it goes to almost 4 meters deep. All right. So many of you M9 and S5 users know that the landing page when you start a measurement is called the Smart Page. So on the bottom tabs here, you'll be able to see the Smart Page. Now, if you do have any errors in the Smart Page or things that you want to change in post-processing, you'll be able to do that from here. So let's, for example, change the magnetic declination. Let's change it to negative 20. And Now, if you click OK, this setting will be applied to this current transect, or you can select apply to all for all the transects. Now for a parameter like magnetic declination, you'll probably want to just apply to all. And once you hit OK, all of your discharges will be updated accordingly. Now this, as I mentioned, applies to RS5 data files already collected, but don't forget that you can also open RIV and RIVR files from an M9 or an S5. So that really opens up your capabilities for post-processing those M9 or S5 files. All right, so let's move on to some new features that you won't see in, for example, the RiverSurveyor Live software. So the first one I want to talk about is Extrap. So Extrap is a USGS tool that goes with QRev, and it basically helps you decide on extrapolations. And I've clicked discharge settings and clicked through to our Extrap dialog. Now this is actually a very familiar screen to all of you QRev users because this is the Extrap code that's embedded directly to RSQ. So from here, you'll be able to decide on your proper extrapolations and either apply to the current transect or apply to everything. And let's just click apply to all, and we'll have, again, all of your discharge values updated. Now, since I mentioned QRev, yes, indeed, you'll be able to export to MATLAB, which then is fed into QRev. So we've been working closely with the USGS in terms of making all the RS5 or RSQ exported files compatible with QRev. So that functionality is definitely there. Something else that you might be interested in is the Google Earth export. So let me just export this selected transect. And now we're going to be prompted to call this file, the KML file, something. So I just called it test. And you'll see that Google Earth then automatically pops up and will zoom into the location of the transect. Now this data file was actually collected by USGS in Connecticut. So now you'll see the various ship tracks popping up where the transect was collected. And obviously, you know, you need to have a GPS functioning in order to place it on a map in Google Earth or any other piece of plotting software. So if you're running either the M9, S5, or the RS5 with bottom track only, you won't be able to place it on a map. But if you do have GPS here, then you'll be able to export to Google Earth and have a nice plot of your measurement. All right, and the final interesting thing I wanted to talk about today is what we call beam switching. And in order to demonstrate that, I'm going to open an M9 file. So right now I'm actually clicking Shift on the keyboard, and then I click on Open File. And you'll see that now the software is looking for RiverSurveyor M9 or S5 data files. So I'm going to click into my folder, and this is the RIVR file that I want to open. All right, so with beam switching, we often have files that kind of look like this near edges. Now what's happening here is that we have a four-beam system where one beam is hitting a vertical wall. Now, as we get closer and closer to the wall, that beam is getting shallower and shallower. And since the M9 or the RS5 is going to pick the shallowest beam in order to calculate velocity, those data are going to be cut off shallower and shallower. So that's why you see this kind of triangular shape as you get closer to the wall. So we can actually salvage that data from the other three beams, the good data that's not hitting the wall, by using the beam switching feature. So that's in discharge settings, beam switching. And the dialog that pops up, you'll see the various beams for each individual depth. And again, that speed contour plot on the bottom. And so for example, this transect in particular, you'll see this yellow beam very automatically just pops out as being impacted by the wall. It goes very shallow very quickly. And so let's remove that from the velocity calculation and try to salvage data from the other three beams. All right, so When you click Add here, we are going to pick this yellow beam, beam 4, and let's remove starting from the first sample all the way to about 37. Click OK, and now you'll notice immediately that speed contour plot was filled in. So now we're recalculating velocities using those three good beams that are not hitting the wall. And then that yellow beam, that depth, is dotted out here, so it's not being used. Since we're here, why don't we just remove this other beam here, the blue beam, as well. And it's impacting the wall on the other side. So let's start the sample at, let's say 72. And end the sample at the very end, so 94. And there we have it. So we've filled in the transect where we originally didn't have any data. And you'll notice that once I clicked OK, we have a nice full flat transect for a cross-section that's basically two vertical walls and a flat bottom here. So that's a useful way to salvage your data when you have one beam impacted. Now, a reminder here, you don't actually need to have vertical walls to use this feature. Say you have something in the middle of your channel where one beam hits some feature like a rock that you didn't want it to hit, or a tree stump or something like that. If you notice that in your data, you can use this beam switching feature to actually remove that and do a three-beam calculation in order to still salvage your data. So again, a new feature that you can use on RS5 data as well as M9 or S5 data. All right, so with that, let's move on to some basic functionality that most of you will probably touch when you're using post-processing techniques. So one of the things that is very common for people to look at, and while I'm talking about that, let me open up a different data file. One of the things that people want to look at is the discharge summary. So let's hit Control S here for discharge summary. And you'll see this table that pops up on the bottom of the screen. This is our discharge summary, and it'll list every single transect that's collected. Now you can toggle these on and off to be included or not included in the mean calculation. But this table basically summarizes all of your measurements. So you'll see the duration, the total queue, and various other parameters. And you know, with these parameters, again, if you right-click, you'll be able to pick what you want to see and what you don't want to see. So with the discharge summary, you'll be able to have a couple more useful tools here. When you right-click, you can select Extract Subsection to a New Transect. Now, this is useful when, for example, some customers will take a very long transect without breaking it up just because it's easier. Say you're in a flooding condition and you don't want to start and stop a measurement every time. You don't have time to do that. Or you are just interested in a certain small section of your channel and you want to know the flow or the queue in just that small section. So this is a way to kind of break up a transect and recalculate everything in a smaller section. So when you open that dialog, you'll be able to set a left and a right bank. Now you have to set a left and a right bank in order to calculate discharge. So let's play around with that briefly. So left bank, distance left bank, let's keep that the same, but let's chop off the ends here and start the left bank, let's say somewhere at sample 230. And let's say we end at 240. Now you'll see this grayed out area that pops up, and that's our new left bank here. And then with the right bank, let's keep that same distance setting and chop it off earlier. Let's see, sample 270 and 280. I'm keeping 10 samples just because normally we want to keep 10 good samples for a bank. All right, so you see your new transect. Your two edges are in these gray areas, and then your transect calculation for discharge will be in the middle here. So once I hit OK, you will see a new transect that pops up. We had 4 originally here in this data file. This is a new one, transect 5, and you'll see on the list here, we have a new queue that's much less than the other ones because we've chopped up our transect, and this is basically a new transect that you can either store with all the other transects of the original measurement, or you can remove and store it as its own transect. So in order to do that, you can hit measurement, save as, and save this new file, including this new truncated transect for you. All right, so I've mentioned that, again, the data files collected with the RS5 and the data structure of RSQ keeps all transects together in one big file. You have the ability to, for example, delete a transect if you didn't like this new subsection. Let's go ahead and remove that. And now that's gone. And you can save as into a new file if you like. And just a reminder that we never overwrite existing data files that are collected in the field. So if anyone attempts to do that with RSQ, you'll get a warning and you'll just never be able to overwrite original data. And one of the things from the discharge summary that you might want to use is an export to a summary report. So once you do that, your summary report will pop up with all of your various information, discharges, your results from your measurement, and then plots and details on your measurement. So this is more for bookkeeping and record keeping. And I know many agencies require this sort of printout, so then you can save this as a PDF report. All right. One of the useful things that you might want to play around with when you're doing your post-processing is this toolbox. So I'm clicking Window, Show Toolbox. You can also select Control T. But this brings up this hovering toolbox on the right here. And with that, you have quick, easy access to various things that you might want to change during your measurement. Let's say you wanted to change your system configuration and you wanted to change your depth reference to bottom track, and before it was vertical beam. So let's just hit apply all. And again, your Q values and everything else will be changed automatically. And if you didn't like any of the changes that you've made, you can go back and let me just show you here. Items that are changed are highlighted in a different color. And if you're on your discharge summary, you can right click and hit reset to field settings to go back to your original settings when the data were collected. So now you see this depth reference go back to vertical beam. So these are just some of the handy, useful tools that you will likely use a lot once you're familiar with the workflow of RSQ. And I hope that some of these will be useful to you. So that's all I have for you today, folks. We're really excited to be able to put in all of these new features that you've requested over the years. And so we invite you to, again, download the software, check out the data sample files, and take it for a spin. Let us know what you think. More information can be found at sontech.com, and I look forward to seeing you out in the field sometime soon. Bye-bye.